which we can talk about, which allows me to sit here and talk lucidly to you about it.
I know. That's pretty miraculous right then and there. And I didn't know that if you would be open. And so all I could do was ask, but I thought, you know, it might be cathartic for one thing. And another, because it is so tenderly fresh, others might hear this and say, okay, I need to do something about perhaps there's someone in their life who is facing the same kind of struggle and addiction, of course. So let's get to a little bit about Drew and how much you have adored this young boy.
Well, thanks for teeing that up. You and I talked about this offline a little bit. But Drew, when he was born on April 10th, 1988, it was the happiest day of my life. I just had a feeling overcome me that, wow, my life can go on even though maybe I won't be here. And he gave me kind of a license to kill, in other words, to go out and really hunt as a businessman. And I had a new attitude to go out and do that. And I have that same attitude since Drew's passing because we're in a war for souls, and the gloves are off. I mean, my firstborn son was taken from me, and I got a raw anger about that, but I think directed in the right place at Satan himself. But in terms of my love for Drew, he was an amazing friend. He always had my back, a little bit of a blind faith in Dad. But I look back over our texts even this morning, and there was just a lot of I love yous back and forth mixed in with all the other events of the day. And God was good. We had a great 4 days together in February. We went to Epcot Center, Disney World. He was strong as ever. He looked brilliant. Drew was had a very captivating personality. He was way smarter than me, and he was a beautiful man. I mean, he was an Abercrombie model, and drew a lot of people to him. Just his aesthetic correctness when he walked into the room. Just a bright kid.
So when you say that the two of you had time at Epcot together, it was just the two of you.
It was just us going to have fun. I texted to him, "How much fun can we have?" And thank God my wife, Christine, supported us just going down and playing together. And we had a dream weekend capped off by a Super Bowl Sunday night. And Drew played a song that night, which I captured on video, which is at drewswan.com, about faith. And that has gotten me through this hard time because he talks about how it's a bridge across the gate.
Wow. So more about Drew Swan and, of course, his dad, Greg Swan, here in the studio with me right now on the Praise Company Witness Today.
Love is not proud. Love does not boast. Love, after all, matters the most. Love does not run. Love does not hide. Love does not keep locked inside. Love is a river that flows through, and love never fails you. Love will sustain. Love will provide. Love will not cease at the end of time. And love will protect. Love always hopes. And love still believes when you don't. Love is the arms that are holding you. Love never fails you. When my heart won't make a sound, when I can't turn back around, when the sky is falling down, nothing is greater than this, greater than this. 'Cause love is right here, love is alive, love is the way, the truth, the life. Love is the river that flows through. Love is the arms that are holding you. And love is a place you will fly to. Love never fails you.
WMUZ 103.5 FM, Love Never Fails. There's the music of Brandon Heath here on the Praise Company Witness today. My friend Greg Swan gets a phone call, actually, from your son, Jack. And was there a hint that something like this was going to happen? Did you you already knew that Drew, your oldest, struggled with addiction, and for how many years?
About 2.5 years that I was aware of. Oxycontin was his drug of choice. There were variations on that. It actually got into heroin.
How do they ingest that? Is that smoked?
They take pills and then...
Okay. I didn't know. I mean, I know of Oxycontin, and I've heard it is horrendous.
Eventually, the pharmaceutical company that made it saw there was such a high death rate with it that they did a time release on it, which made addicts, it was harder to use, yeah. And then eventually what addicts did is they turned back to heroin. But Christine and I just saw a movie last night. I wouldn't recommend it for Christians, Beyond the Pines, I think it was called.
Okay.
And there was a party where Oxy was being handed out all over the place. And
do you know what is so weird? Do you know what I just realized? I was given that drug. I had a foot surgery, and I was given that drug. And within a half a day, I said, "I can't take that."
That's how it started.
Because it made me feel like horrible. I mean, I was like, "This was like it was." I can't believe it. It just dawned on me.
Yeah, Brett Favre of the Packers came out and said, "I'm going into treatment for addiction to prescription painkillers," and that's what it is.
Oh,
it's Oxy.
Wow. So it's anybody could have that.
Absolutely.
Oh,
and it's completely addictive,
goodness.
And the pharmaceutical companies are really not being held to account. But you gotta do preventative stuff. So this show is good and helpful for anybody whose kid is struggling with addiction. It does lead down this path, and it's sad. Drew had a really good year before I think he spiraled in the last couple of weeks, and what was found in his body was methadone, which is to fight withdrawal symptoms, and it was a normal amount. He was working out with something called Explode to help him work out, but I don't know what the formal toxicology hasn't come in yet. But to your question about Jack's phone call, yeah, he called me at 12:30 at night. Christine saw the call coming in, and he hasn't needed me since high school, late at night. It's the call no parent ever wants to get, and
no.
I picked up the phone the second time, and he said, "Dad," I said, "Yes, Jack." He said, "Dad, are you sitting up?" I said, "No, I'm sleeping." He goes, "Dad, I need you to be sitting up." So at that point, I knew something was really wrong. I said, "I'm sitting up, Jack." He says, "Drew's dead," like that. And he didn't need to say it twice. I mean, I started screaming. I have since had very serious apologetic sessions with God for what I said to God at that time. And I was in shock. Jack's a medical student. He knew his system had gone into shock, and his corpuscles were closing up and all that. But I got in the car and I went over to see him in East Lansing and be together that night. We never went to bed the whole day. And
now, Drew was in Florida. That's
Drew
where he was
in Florida.
Living.
He was discovered by a friend who had dropped him off the night before, and he was walking real slowly into his place. He gave a thumbs up without turning his head back that he was okay. And he walked into this place, and he never woke up.
I'm so sorry.
No, thank you. It's sad because when I was in Farmington, my office is in Detroit now. There was a gal downstairs from me, Diane Rothman, and her son. We both knew our sons were struggling with this, and we followed it along. Then I get this Facebook invitation to his funeral.
Oh my!
And I go to that funeral.
When was this?
This was like a year ago.
Oh,
I just
my.
Saw her recently for lunch, and it was a year ago. And I went to Timothy Rothman's funeral. And so I told Drew, "Don't you ever let this happen, you know, to me." And we watched it in slow motion. And I belong to Al-Anon, among other 12-step groups, and just you're powerless over it despite trying to reach out to these kids.
Right. Well, you're powerless over it, but God is all-powerful. And thank God you have a relationship with Him. Now, just imagine if you hadn't cried out to God. I mean, no matter what it was that you said, I'm sure that you didn't shock God. Just as David never shocked God when he cried out to him, you know, angry with God. You know, why have you forsaken me? Why, you know, why do you let your enemies or my enemies trample over me? And he just cried out from a heart that was hurting. And so were you. And that didn't shock God. He's so merciful.
Yeah, he's a big boy. I think he's okay with it. We were joking together about it later on, but I found comfort in him. I never thought I'd have a relationship with God if anything happened to my kids. It's just the opposite. Right. He's my only shot at peace and you know, the ability to move forward, which he's allowing me to do.
Right. This is the Praise Company Witness today, and we'll continue with Greg Swan here in the studio telling his story of losing his son within this past month, and it's been less than a month that he's been gone. And we're going to talk about where Drew is now and how Greg knows that he is where he is. Goodwin and Jessica, I want to thank them for sponsoring this show. They're just wonderful attorneys, and they came right alongside us as soon as the show began back in December. You know, I want to be a part of the Praise Company Witness today. I know that Goodwin and Cheska will fight for your rights in the court of law like nobody else will. They'll roll up their sleeves and they'll do their very best to win for you.
When you're a patient in the operating room, you trust that you are in the best of care. Shockingly, doctors make nearly 4,000 surgical mistakes per year, according to a study out of Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine.
Hi, I'm Scott Goodwin of the Goodwin and Cheska Law Center. If you've been injured due to doctor neglect, you need an expert on your side to make sure you receive the full financial compensation you are legally entitled to. You can be awarded money for doctor bills, lost wages, or even pain and suffering related to your case. But it's not going to be easy. You're going to need someone to fight for you. You need us, Scott Goodwin and Jim Cheska.
Goodwin and Cheska have been winning more money for their clients against negligent hospitals and doctors since 1986. If you think you have a case, make the call today. 1-888-GOODWIN.
1-888-GOODWIN.
There are never any legal fees unless you collect. Dial 1-888-GOODWIN and win with Goodwin.
Goodwin and Jessica are amazing attorneys, and they will fight for your rights in the court of law. You know, I'm just reminded that it was about 1 year ago that Scott Goodwin lost his mom. And, you know, we've all faced loss, haven't we? And loss, I mean, it's tragic. Loss to death is so, well, in this world, it is final. And yet, as a believer in Jesus Christ, it is not final. Thank God for that. Now, Greg, prior to this, I know that you've had loss in your life. You know, you lost your mom, right, many years ago.
Yeah, I was 33. She was too young to go. She was my best friend at the time.
Yeah, and then you went through and suffered through a divorce, which is tremendous loss.
Yeah, it's really tough. To anybody contemplating a divorce, you might want to do a U-turn on that one, because what you're going to experience when that happens is like a death.
Yeah, and I know that you struggled with that. I mean, you know, we've known each other for a long time, mm-hmm. and you were telling me just a few years back about that period in your life that was really, really tough. But God does amazing things in our lives, and he certainly has done a major work in your life to restore mm-hmm. and give you just a precious woman mm-hmm. who loves you.
Yeah, my wife, Christine Bonds, is amazing. She predates everything in my life. I met her in January of 1980. We were doing a play together.
What was the play?
It was Bye Bye Birdie.
Oh, yeah.
She stole the show as a young 14-year-old.
Oh, did she?
Yes.
And she's the daughter of Bill Bonds.
She is Bill Bonds' daughter.
Right.
And, she, you know, Christine, you know, it was a well-known, she went on professionally in acting. And
that was my Phantom of the Opera.
Oh, okay.
Like
oh, right. Oh, no, that was good. That
oh,
was great.
Oh, thank you. Okay.
Christine went on to professionally act and all that, but mm-hmm. she got out of Dodge under the shadow of her dad and went to New York. But she lost a sister in 1981 on December 16th. That's right. It was also a drunken driving incident, maybe on both sides. And Christine has an edge about addiction that she doesn't really tolerate people's playing nice in the sandbox, half in, half out. She's like black and white. Addiction kills. And of course, I have the same mantle and platform now about that as well. And we're not joking around, folks. It's not fun.
Right. And it does. It takes lives. Mm-hmm. It strips lives and affects multiple hundreds of people.
Yeah.
If not thousands. And here's your precious young, you know, vulnerable son. He was 24 years old. Mm-hmm. He would have been 25 the week after. Mm-hmm. And he is no longer here because of addiction. You said that he grappled with it, you think, for about two and a half years. So he didn't have struggles when he was in high school? Or?
I think Drew started on marijuana occasionally in eighth grade. He was like the Ferris Bueller in high school. Eventually, right before he interned with me a couple of years ago, he had shared with his brother that he had had a problem with Oxy, and he went to Australia on a student study thing for like 5 months, and he did great there, and came back, interned with me, and fell back into it when he went back to Milwaukee, and I'm in the 12-step program too. I'm proud to say, and I'm thrilled to give God credit and glory that I have not drank or drugged over his death. I mean, I've wanted to escape the pain many, many times. But
I would imagine.
Many times. But yeah. The thing is, you have to be in the program to be able to understand addict to addict how to stay clean and sober. And Drew didn't have that support system, so that is... that's a death knell right there.
Well, you were a support system to him, though.
I was, and
a distance.
He knew what Dad thought about it. We went to meetings together. He did go to a rehab in that time period, and he got really strong. He was managing a Abercrombie store down in Florida, living on his own. He was beautiful. He was buff. You know, life was good. It was great to be Drew Swan at that time.
But he was chained.
He was chained because he fell back into it, and he didn't stay close to the program. And without, you know, those that don't go to meetings don't find out what happens to those that don't go to meetings is a saying we have in the program. So
wow, okay. This is the Praise Company Witness today. More about Drew Swan and his death. His dad here in the studio talking about his behavior, is addiction, and how you can get set free, and you can know the freedom that is only and can only come through Jesus Christ. There is no other way. He is the what is that step called?
Step three is the one where you turn it all over. It's the born again step.
Okay. To the higher power, and the highest power is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Making big deals out of small ones, bearing gifts as if they're burdens. This is how it's been. Fear of coming out of my shell. Too many things I can't do too well. Afraid I'll try real hard and I'll fail. This is how it's been. Till the day you pounded on my heart's door and you shouted joyfully, you're not a slave anymore. Your two left feet, and you're free to sing. Even joyful noise, music to me. And free in love, cause I have given my love, and it's made you free. Free. My mind finds hard to believe that you've become humanity and changed the course of history because you left me so. And my heart cannot understand why you'd accept me as I am. But you see, you've always had a plan, and that's all I need to know. So when I am consumed by what the world will say, it's then you're singing to
WMUC 103.5 FM. We just got a call here in the studio. Charles gave us a call because he wanted to pray for Greg, and he did. Wasn't he sweet to do
awesome.
That? Yeah, I know. God is good. You know, the body of Christ needs to help one another, love one another, and not judge one another. And one of the reasons why I've asked you to come here is because this is real life. This really happened. This is, you wish it were a really bad dream and it would go away, I'm sure. I'm sure you wish you could rewind the clock, Greg, and say, I'm never going to get that phone call. You know, I'm never going to have that last text. You know, I'm going to see him again. But the thing is that you will see him again, not in this life, which is hard. That's for sure. And that is very painful. But because you're a believer in Jesus Christ and because Drew was, you have hope. Tell me what Jesus tells you today.
So, you know, this morning, you know, Drew is my firstborn son, and I did have some quiet time, and I was listening to the Holy Spirit, and Drew was the source of my pride, the firstborn, and he lived up to it, too. He did not disappoint. But with his passing, perhaps the way he passed, but more importantly, just the fact he was taken out of my life,
right.
He's become the source of my humility.
Right.
I'm not driving the bus here, Robin. A really bad thing happened, and it was out of my control, and I realized that I'm just not calling the shots here. I did listen to some good teaching by a guy named Andrew Womack. I do not believe God took Drew for his purpose. I don't believe he needed to add to his 10 million angels in heaven.
Right.
And there's some solid steps at the bottom of drewswan.com on how to overcome grief. It's that teaching by Andrew Womack. It was excellent. Mm-hmm. 4 hours of heavy biblical counseling about that.
And you've listened to that since his death?
I have. I've recently.
You've inundated yourself with good teaching.
Well, I'm trying to,
which is smart.
I'm in the 12-step program, and I try to leverage other people's experience so that I don't have to live it out and wait 6 months and realize I'd had my head in the sand.
Wow.
Maybe I can take a shortcut. Now, you'd ask me about, you know,
I think that most people would be paralyzed at this point in time. But instead, you know, it's amazing to me, and I believe it's the grace of God that you have your, I don't know how else to say it, but like your wits about you, that you can actually plow in and try and find ways or avenues for you to get healing. I think that's unbelievable and powerful. But that's because you're healthy in your relationship with God. Let's go back to the 12-step thing.
Sure.
Because for some people, they think that the 12-step thing is not a godly thing. So
we
got to clarify that, because I know that it has godly principles, but help me out with that.
Sure. So if you know somebody, if you're a Christian and you know somebody in the 12-step program, or if you're a Christian and you know somebody who's Catholic, not to offend anybody who's Catholic, I grew up Catholic,
mm-hmm.
It's really easy to witness to these people. Step 3 is the sinner's prayer, and there's a 12-step.
Is it really?
Oh,
no.
Well, it is. Turn your life and your will over to your higher power as you understand him. So, and you can explain to somebody who that higher power is. Of course, he's not confused who he is. So Rick Warren decided, you know, that we needed to have a Christian equivalent of this. So he started something called Celebrate Recovery, which is a Christian equivalent. I do belong to that as well and benefit greatly from that.
Mm.
And you go and you talk about your hurts, habits, and hang-ups and get deliverance for that.
Okay.
And there's a...
Rick
there's
Warren, the author of Purpose Driven Life.
Who happened to lose his son right after mine.
I know!
So people are looking at Rick Warren. How is he going to handle this?
Yes.
And it was really unfortunate. The kid was, I guess, bipolar and committed suicide, which is a real tough one to swallow. I know that didn't happen with Drew, and I do know that Drew was a Jesus freak, and he's a Christian, and I know his name is written in the Book of Life, and I know he's in heaven. I have no problem knowing that. He is separated from me until I see him again.
Right.
And, you know, it's going to be a great day. I thought about it this morning.
It is going to be a great day. Wow. So the Lord told you what was the source of your pride is now the source of your humility.
Absolutely.
It's amazing. Now, that's only something that the Spirit of God could tell you and that you could take. You know, he's so gracious, isn't he? This is the Praise Company Witness today on WMUZ, The Light. Here's Toby Mack. More with Greg Swan coming up.
Wake up to the morning light. Wipe away the lonely night.
Let a brand new day wash over you. Wanna see you smile again. Show some love to your crazy friends. Wipe your tears away, those days are through. If you move just a little bit closer, you can put your head on my shoulder. Yeah, yeah. We gotta hold on, just another day or two. I can see the clouds are moving faster now, and the sun is breaking through. If you can hold on to the one that's holding you, there is nothing that can stop this crazy love from breaking through. We're breaking through. Up to the rising sun, thank the Lord for the things he's done. Lift your eyes to the hope that's ever true. Wanna see you smiling, girl. You're a light in this jaded world. Wipe away those tears, this one's for you. And come on, move a little bit closer. You can put your head on my shoulder. Stop this crazy love from breaking through. And the stars are up there shining for you. Oh, how the Father does adore you. His love will never change. And you and I, we were born to follow the hope that will lead us to tomorrow. And no one can take it away. We gotta hold on just another day or two. I can see the clouds are moving faster now, and the sun is breaking through. If you can hold on to the one that's holding you, there is nothing that can stop this crazy, crazy love from breaking. You gotta hold on. I can see the clouds are moving faster now, and the sun is breaking. Stop this crazy, crazy love from breaking. Throwing your back up in the morning, just another day or two. You see the clouds are moving faster now. The clouds are moving faster.
WMUZ 103.5 FM. Hold on, there's Toby Mack here on the Praise Company Witness today. And Greg Swan is here in the studio with me. You tell me that there is someone who was a Toby Mack fanatic.
Yes, I just came across this text from Drew. He says, dude, Toby Mack, Lecrae, forgiveness, your boy from DC Talk knows how to throw down on the lift up music. Check it out.
Oh, is that what he wrote? Yeah. Oh, that's so great. Well, we'll play forgiveness. Oh, that's so great. Look, he's showing me his phone right now. Oh, that's awesome. We'll play forgiveness right at the very end of the show. How's that sound?
Fantastic.
Okay. I've got Lillian Easterly Smith on the line with me right now. She is from Life Care Christian Center, and Lillian has been working with people with addictive behavior for years. And Lillian, I'm so glad you joined us. How are you?
Thank you. I'm doing well, Robin. How about yourself?
Good. So you're hearing my friend Greg and his story about his son.
Yes, and Greg, I just want to personally say I'm so sorry for your loss, and I certainly can appreciate it and understand it to a degree, only because I've lost family members as well to addiction. And I've enjoyed listening to you. I love that you're talking about the 12 steps and that you're in recovery yourself. And I've been in recovery now for, let's say, oh man, I'm losing track here, probably 28 years.
Wow, congratulations. And nice to meet you.
Yes, nice to meet you.
Just today, you know, I was talking with Lillian a little bit earlier, and she actually lost her father, and he had submitted his life to the Lord and was in recovery for how many years, Lillian?
My father was sober for 20 years, and he found his sobriety in AA, and I would say after working the steps and being in AA for about 7 years is when he met the Lord Jesus Christ, and him and I probably got saved right around the same time, and I got into recovery pretty close to the time right after that. So we enjoyed some wonderful years together talking about the steps and Jesus, and it was wonderful, and never in a million years did I ever suspect that he would go back to alcohol. But here, 20 years later, full-blown relapse, you could see, you know, the signs, and no matter what we said, no matter what we did, we even did an intervention, and he ended up drinking himself to death.
Wow.
About 6 years ago, yes.
Lillian, I am so sorry. How horrifying.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, here's this man who he knew God. He had submitted his life to Jesus. So can I just ask you, and this is a hard question, and a lot of people, it may raise some eyebrows right now, but do you believe you know where he is?
I am absolutely positive that he is in heaven with our Lord right now. One of the devastating things about alcohol and any form of substance abuse and addiction is it will rob us of the life that I believe God really intended for us to live. You know, my dad was robbed. However, as I look at his behavior and his choices, I see very clearly where the relapse came in. And so a lot of times I use his story to help others. And I loved what Greg was saying earlier, that this tremendous loss in his life, now God, hopefully, and we know he will, he's going to use this to reach others, other young people that are caught in the throes of addiction. And we can challenge them. We can say, you don't have to go down that same path.
Right.
You don't have to lose your life. You don't have to go the route of insanity. You can find recovery and healing, but you have to be willing to do the work. You have to be willing to cooperate with the Spirit of God. You know, my dad, I believe, you know, he got so far in his recovery, but I think that there was a lot of inventory stuff. We talk about fourth step and fifth step stuff where we have to look back at our past. We have to heal from those hurts. We have to deal with those sins, and we have to make amends for the wrongs that we've done.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that that was, you know, one of the biggest steps that tripped him up. I think he did it, you know, to a certain degree, but he didn't go to that depth that all of us have to go to. Because let's face it, the addiction is just a symptom of the problem.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And Greg, you know that, right?
No, it's cunning,
you've
baffling,
been in recovery.
Powerful. Yeah, it's cunning,
yeah.
Baffling, powerful. And you mentioned this inventory. I was in a meeting on Saturday, and it's almost amazing, but non-addicts, alcoholics, they don't have to go through the step four. So you run into a lot of undeveloped people, dysfunctional, if you will, who really don't look at themselves, accept responsibility for what they've done, and go back and make amends and fix the wrongs that they've done in their life.
Right.
And it's necessary, and it's a very freeing thing in the program. And, you know, there's happiness on the other side of
it. Well, it's God's program because, you know, he says, you know, turn. Repent, mm-hmm. and you know, and be baptized. I mean, you have to turn from your sin, and when you do, I mean, it's just amazing how liberating it is. Here in the studio with me, Greg Swan, my dear friend, just lost his son less than a month ago. He was addicted to Oxycontin. Only 24 years old, about to be 25. His life ended. I've got Lillian Easterly on the line with me right now, Lillian Easterly Smith from Life Care Christian Center, and I just want to thank them for joining me here on the Praise Company Witness today, because there are people who are listening right now who need to get set free, who need to repent, who need to offer hope to people that they know who are addicted. And we're going to try and tackle all of that in 20 minutes. We're going to try and do that. We're doing the best that we can because we want to offer hope, because that's where healing takes place. The hope is in Jesus Christ, who is the hope of glory. I have a brand new advertising partner who has joined the ranks here on this show tonight. And I want to thank Dr. Poirier, and I love her name. It's so French. You know what I'm talking about. And so when I met her, I said her name as one would when, you know, you're taking French and you're a little kid. And she said, but that's exactly how you're supposed to say it. Her name is Dr. Nicole Poirier. And here's what she can do for you if you are in pain. Listen to this.
You're in pain. And every minute feels like an eternity. You've taken the meds, and you may have had the surgery, but the pain just won't go away. Stop being sidelined by pain and get back into your life this week by calling Poirier Chiropractic. Poirier Chiropractic is the home of the K-Laser Therapy, a non-invasive, non-surgical approach to pain. This breakthrough in pain management, used by professional sports teams, is a natural way for your body to reduce pain and heal itself quickly by speeding nutrients right to where it hurts. By this time next week, you could be back to normal and totally pain-free. Life is way too short to live with pain. Help your body heal today the natural way with K-Laser Therapy from Poirier Chiropractic. Call Poirier Chiropractic right now at 586-566-5005 to set up your free consultation. You're in pain now. Why wait? Call right now, 586-566-5005.
All right. This is a brand new advertising partner, and I got to tell you that this K-Laser is amazing. I mean, there are, you know, athletes who have gotten healed quickly, instantly, within a week. They were back out on that pitching mound doing great. And it's like, now we have access to that? That's amazing. And you will at Poirier Chiropractic. And Dr. Nicole, thank you so much for joining me. Call 586-566-5005 so that you can be healed. That's it. So you can get out of pain. Get rid of the pain. 586-566-5005. Lillian Easterly Smith here on the line with us, Greg. And I just want to remind everyone that she's fabulous. She's got this ministry called Life Care Christian Center. And I am inviting you right now, Lillian, if you would join me next week on the Praise Company Witness Today, can you come into the studio and maybe we can help a whole lot of people? Because I know that that's what you're about, right?
It certainly is. I would love to, Robin. Thank you for asking.
Okay. So
next Wednesday it is, right?
Okay, let's do it. Next Wednesday it's in the books. Can you offer something to Greg right now, being that this is so new and this, you know, it's fresh in his life? Is there something that you can share with him to minister to him right now?
Oh, I would love to. Greg, as you know, I know you've already done a lot of reading and praying, and the Lord has really been ministering to your heart. I guess I just would like to remind you that grief always comes in waves. I think it's important for you to realize that even though maybe today you're having a great day, tomorrow there may be waves, and it's just going to hit you out of the blue. And my encouragement to you is to just fully embrace it. Let the sadness come, and then release that to the Lord. And there will be times where it feels it's so heavy on you that it's unbearable. I mean, sometimes I think grief feels like your heart is literally, physically breaking in two. And it's okay. I mean, it's okay to feel that. It doesn't mean that you're less of a man or that your relationship with God is shaky or any of that. It's the fact that we are human beings. We're feeling beings. And so we're going to have times where it's just difficult. And I'm thankful, you know, for everything that I've already heard from you. I know that you have a deep connection with God. You know that you're going to see your son again someday. But the bottom line is, he's not here with you anymore. So you're going to miss all the firsts, you know, when you think about, you know, the times when he could have, should have been getting married or having children. I mean, this is going to be a lifelong journey for you. I heard it said one time, and it's always stuck with me, that losing a loved one, you know, it's like being amputated. You know, you're going to heal, but you're never going to be the same. Mm-hmm. You have lost a limb. You've lost a significant part of your life. But like you said, we all have the hope in Christ, knowing that he accepted Jesus, he loved Jesus, and so we will all be united with him one day.
Oh, and what a
Thank
day.
You so much.
What a day that will be. Let the Lord wrap his arms around you, Greg. How's that? This is the Praise Company Witness today on WMUZ The Light. WMUZ 103.5 FM. I've got my friend Greg Swan here in the studio with me. This is a worship song called Wrap Me in Your Arms. So often I can see in the spirit, Greg, when someone is needing comfort, that I just see the arms of God. I don't see his face, but I can just see his arms large, just enwrap himself around us. And holding us. I remember when I myself was going through a very painful time. This is years ago when I went through divorce. And I remember having the day off of pain. And that's the only way I could describe it. It was like I had the day off. And I was thinking, how did that happen? And I felt as though the Spirit of God said to me, you know where you are right now? You're not hiding under the shelter of my wings. I put you on top of them. And I'm moving. And you know, I'm giving you the day off of pain.
Beautiful.
And that's an amazing thing. But like Lillian said, but there are, it's an ebb and flow. Mm-hmm. And
she's right.
She is. And the fact is that not everyone's going to get that. Not everyone's going to allow you, you know, the tears and the ranting and the.
I mean, it stops you. Sometimes it buckles my knees.
Yeah.
And you can't move. And, you know, it hits you. Jogging. I talked to my son Jack at the same day. We were both like broken. Mm. But the reality is, you know, there's a survival instinct. I mean, you could just devolve into nothing. So that's one option.
Yeah.
You know, or you can get up and get some of these healings that God has offered, and we've taken advantage of them. But I'm looking for, you know, Drew had a prophecy over his life that he would be mightily used of God. And I thought, boy, that dream came to an end, and that prophecy must have been not true. And then today I was reading Jesus on the Road to Emmaus, and they said, hey, your life, are you the only one in Jerusalem that hasn't heard about this guy, Jesus? He died. We thought he was going to be used, and nothing came of it. And there was a prophecy about Jesus, and my old father-in-law, Wayne Rolfs, said, you know what? The devil thought he had the victory when he killed Jesus, too.
Yeah.
So Drew's a seed and planted in the ground, and there's more to come, and there's a lot of hope at his tribute site, drewswan.com. There's a message there: I died, saw hell, and met Jesus. An interview that I did with
a
woman.
Suggested, yeah, that I look at that, and I could not get over it. You interviewed her?
Yeah, that was me interviewing her.
That was you?
That was me. No. Hello. That's why I turned you on to it.
Greg, I didn't know that. No, I didn't. You look totally different.
Well, I'm 10 years younger. Okay. It's 2001.
Well, you had like glasses on or something and dark hair. What was going on?
Well, look, here's...
It's so funny. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Here's what's interesting
about... That's funny.
I had no idea. Here's what's interesting. She was amazing. She died of the same thing that the boy in Heaven Is For Real died of on the operating table, of appendicitis. What are the odds of that? So she was dead and then, you know, went into the afterlife and saw... Yeah, that was me. I know you can't get over that, but
I really can't. So because,
if you go to drewswan.com and I just assumed that.
Okay.
But can I tell about the healing thing that happened with you? You said to get that book?
Yeah.
So you said, get that book. I read that book. I devoured it because it gave me some comfort about the afterlife. And the author, Lynn Vincent, of Heaven Is For Real, I realized at the very end of that book was a very familiar name. I had prayed, God, you know, throw me down something today. And she was the woman who interviewed me when we put 30 million Bibles on CD-ROM inside General Mills cereal boxes. And she interviewed me. It was a national news story in World Magazine.
That's amazing. And I
don't throw that out there to point out that I did that. It was a comfort to me, a special comfort to me, that the same person who wrote a story that comforted me about heaven being for real, also I knew personally and had done this story. So God does work in mysterious ways. And
the reason
I sought you out is you're a buddy. And I said, if you didn't know Drew, if you don't know Jesus, I didn't really want to talk to anybody at the time. I knew you knew Jesus. Other people know Drew. That's all I had room for at that time.
That's amazing. Phyllis is on the line right now, and Phyllis is getting comforted by this, by our conversation and by this evening's program. Phyllis, hi. Yes. How are you doing tonight?
I'm doing better. I walked a similar walk. A friend of mine lost her son to a murder, and I lost my son after 5 years to a failed adoption. And we frequently laugh together and cry together, and I just am going to pray for you and other people like you that have gone through a walk and helped other people and realize that we're not going to give Satan the power to destroy our lives, even though we will walk through pain every once in a while.
Right.
Sometimes worse than others, but, you know, you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you, and if you give Satan the power, you've just thrown all that away, and I'm not going to give him that much power.
Oh,
I might cry a little more, but I'll get through it.
That's good. Well, I'm so glad that you were listening at this time. This is the Praise Company Witness today. And Greg, I hope you don't mind my asking you if you could just describe this beautiful little picture. Who is that in front of you?
So I have this beautiful boy named Nathaniel, and he's from Indonesia.
Mm-hmm.
And it looks like he needs to be sponsored as a child today by Compassion International.
Well, I've got little Lizzie. Wait till you see. Look at
her. She's adorable. I want them both.
I know. She's got this little lavender dress on. She's lives in Honduras. And for those of you who may be going to One Nation one day and participating in that, you know, you could sponsor this little girl in advance. Who knows, your paths may cross when you go. That's, by the way, a huge event that's coming up in July, where literally thousands of missionaries are going to descend upon Honduras in 1 week. And it's pretty amazing. And it's through Dominic Russo.
What? Oh, yeah. Our Dominic?
Yeah,
oh,
well, our Dominic. Yeah. Well, there are a couple of Dominic Russos. Yeah. And we know both of them, right? But this is Lizzie. She's from Honduras, born on April 23rd. She needs a sponsor today. She's being raised by her grandparents. And we would love to hear from you right now at 313-838-1035. It's $38 a month, a tax-deductible gift. It breaks down to about $1.25 a day. And so instead of stopping and, you know, buying a bottle of water, you know, fill up your water and just sponsor this little girl or Nathaniel or Nate or whatever. And where is he from?
He is from Indonesia.
Oh, how sweet. And his birth date is what?
His birth date is March 11th, 2004.
Okay. 313-838-1035. Now, when you come to Jesus, whether it happens emotionally or whether it happens physically or not, sometimes that is a process, as we've been learning tonight. But the Lord says that he whom the Son of God sets free is free indeed. And the shackles that bind us can and will break off. Da-da-da. Da-da-da. Da-da-da.
my mind, I just can't seem to find
a reason to believe
that I can break free.
I couldn't break free,
'cause I've been down for so long, feel like all hope is gone.
But as I lift my hands,
I understand that I should praise through my circumstances.
Let's get the shackles off my feet so I can dance.
I can dance.
I just wanna praise you. I just wanna praise you.
I just wanna praise you.
So much pressure fell on me.
I thought I was gonna lose my mind.
But I know you wanna see if I will hold on through these trials. But I need you to lift this load, 'cause I can't take it no more.
Take a
the shackles off my feet so I can dance. I just wanna praise you. I just wanna praise you.
I just wanna praise you.
You broke the chains, now I can't.
WBMZ 103.5 FM, there is Go Fish. If ever there were something that could depict what it's like to be addicted, to have an addictive behavior, it's to see chains on somebody. And God can break those chains, which is an amazing thing. Because you see, God is all powerful. There is nothing too hard for him. This is the Praise Company Witness today, and Little Lizzie is being sponsored by the Sanders family. Actually, this little girl called me.
Praise the Lord.
Isn't that awesome? I've got
a cute
Greg.
One.
I know, isn't she sweet? My friend Greg Swan here in the studio with me, and we're going to talk about the devastation of loss again tomorrow night with you, if you don't mind.
Sounds
and we're
going to
continue that. He's showing me a picture of him and his son at Epcot, and that's what was that, like only 5-6 weeks prior to
February 2nd?
Oh, okay.
We,
so it was a
we went
months.
Around and
yeah.
There's a video pictorial. We went around and took pictures with a cute girl from everywhere around the world, and we made a calendar called Women Around the World, and
oh, that's
had
fun.
A blast.
Oh, that's so great. Yeah. Now, there was no one significant in his life at the time that
he had
passed,
a true
right?
love named Allie in Milwaukee. He was waiting to get all squared away so he could go back and be with her, so he never really glommed on. But he had some really good friends down there, Irwin and Flavia, and a great group, and they had a whole Florida memorial for him down there. So he made some very deep relationships. He has a blog. It's all at drewswan.com, but
okay.
If people could be blessed by that, I'd love it.
Well, I certainly, you know, I went there, and that is so, I still can't get over the fact that you were the one who interviewed that woman who went, she saw hell, and she talked to Jesus, but she was a little girl when that happened, right?
She was 17. She died on an operating table from appendix
17,
burst.
But she was this sweet old woman telling the story, and it was like it happened last week.
Very tough to
she was
look
amazing.
At that and doubt her sincerity. She had no axe to grind, no agenda.
Wow, it's amazing. Well, we're going to have to wait until tomorrow to play the song Forgiveness by Toby Mac with Lecrae. And so that'll bring you back anyway. How's that?
Amen.
Okay. Greg Thanks, Swan, my guest here tonight on WMUZ Detroit on the Praise Company Witness Today. Good night and God bless. Vito Folletti is next.
WMUZ The Light 103.5 FM. I am Vito Folletti. It is Monday night in the city of Detroit, and this is Toby Mac.
I'm a brand new man, I'm a conscious man, I'm a man who's burning for you. The mistakes I made, I've been chased away to the bottom of the ocean blue. I'm a brand new man in a foreign land, I'm a man who's feeling that fire. And it's all so clear when I'm standing here at the peak of my desire. So won't you move me like you used to? I want the world to know. Swept those ghosts in my head, had a grip, but I slipped on by. It's a whole new day as the darkness fades and the sun's climbing in the sky. I can see my love, that I need your love. I'm before you a broken man. And it's only you, no substitutes, who can renew this soul again. So won't you move me like you used to? I want the world to know I burn for you. Kilimanjaro. Got me believing I could save the day. I'm up and running like there ain't no tomorrow. I'd rather burn for you than fade away. I'd rather burn for you than go my way.
I'm a whole new guy with a whole new fire. Change inside, more flame in the fire. Can't stop, won't stop, brand new design. Let the brilliant on the screen feel so energized. Gone without a trace, new face. No more shortness of breath, new pace. Live life now without a taste. Get here till we match. Double dress now, let the smoke.